Good morning. Welcome to EduSet Network. Friend, we are going to discuss development communication. What is it and what are the major components of development communication? What do we mean by the development and communication? And for discussion on this very topic, we have in a studio Professor Saraswati Goswami. She teaches in Indian Institute of Mass Communication and her specialization in development communication and radio communication. So I think her knowledge and experience will help us to understand this topic and give an introductory view, an overview of developmental communication. So on behalf, I welcome her for EduSet lecture on this very topic. Welcome.
Thank you. This is an introductory lecture on development communication. So as an introduction, what we need to do is to understand both development and communication, how they are interlinked and what exactly is meant by it. So we'll start with what is development. Generally, what we tend to think is that achieving modernization is development. Being like the Western world is development. Aspiring to become like the Western world and working towards it is also called development. So broadly speaking, it's Westernization that we are trying to achieve. David Lerner, way back in 1958, tried to understand this phenomenon and said, what the West is, the Middle East seeks to become. What happened was that Lerner was working in the Middle East, so obviously he was talking about Middle East, but it can be as much applicable to the third world countries. In fact, by saying this, Lerner had corroborated Rousseau's theory of modernization. What is this theory of modernization? We just can't go extensively into it. What we can do is, I'll try to give you a little bit of overview of this. The modernization theory believes that development is equal to economic growth. If the country grows economically, so development is achieved. Modernization theory speaks of a particular form of development for the third world countries and about the process to carry it forward. So there is a particular goal to achieve for the third world countries or the underdeveloped or the developing countries, and there is a particular process already laid out to achieve and then go towards modernization. Everett M. Rogers in 1976 had written that this is an outcome of a historical process. Because of industrial evolution in Europe and of course the United States, the colonial experiences in Latin America, Africa and Asia, we all know that many countries in this part of the world, Latin America, Africa and Asia, were colonies. And the quantitative empiricism of North American social science and capitalist economic and political philosophy is because of all these things coming together, there has been a historical process through which modernization had been achieved. However, Rousseau, of course, defines five stages of modernization, which right now we don't need to go through it. If you're more interested, you can go through Rousseau's modernization debate and then understand it more. This paradigm believed that modern technology is the panacea to the development problems of dissemination of the idea of development in the third world countries. So what the main belief was that through modern technology, we can disseminate the ideas of development in the third world countries, and that can act as a panacea to the problems of informing people. Because what is believed is that we cannot inform people of how to achieve modernization, how to achieve development, what is the way to development. So in this particular area, in this particular perspective, modern technology comes handy. So this is the solution to the problem of dissemination of development. Sarvas and Malikhao in 2008 had written a very good book where, in fact, they had edited, and there's a write-up where they had written that modernization is an idea of evolution which implies that development is conceived at first directional and cumulative, secondly predetermined and irreversible, thirdly progressive, and fourthly immanent and with reference to the nation state. It is a very complex idea, but if you go through it clearly, you will find that what they had tried to tell you is that there is a direction, and it has cumulative. And there is a predetermined direction which is irreversible, and it is progressive, and it is in reference to the nation state. Another discourse of development was initiated by the Brazilian educator Paulo Freire, who believed that development means liberation. He said that you cannot achieve development without feeling liberated. Freire's liberation theory presupposes that all people want to be fully human, which already means that liberty and it is to be free and self-reliant, and they have all ability to develop it given a chance. I'll try to explain it for you. What liberation theology believes is that all people want to achieve development, but it can be only through feeling liberated and self-reliant. And because everybody has the ability to develop if given a chance, so it is all about getting them liberated. Thus, purpose of development will be to free both individual and communities from oppression. Hence, it is important that all are liberated. If someone is oppressed, that person or that particular community can never be liberated. And if they are not liberated, they cannot be self-reliant. If they are not self-reliant, they cannot be developed. That was a simple logic of Paulo Freire. However, liberation theology does not offer any critique of modernization theory. The basic premise being that individuals need freedom to choose. So, what exactly was modernization vis-a-vis liberation theory? It is not very clear. It almost seems that modernization vis-a-vis Rousseau's theory is what even the liberation theory was trying to achieve. However, the main critique of modernization theory are the dependency theorists, who believe that the rich North has impoverished the poor South, and the critique emanates from Marxist criticism. So, what the dependency theorists believe is that people have been made dependent on the North because the North had always exploited the South. By North, we are meaning the North of the globe and the South of the globe. It's the divide between the developed and the underdeveloped or developing countries. And they believe, the dependency theorists believe that the North has always exploited South, and through which they had in fact impoverished the South, and thus the Southern countries had always become underdeveloped. Leading American Marxist economist Paul Barron elaborately explained the theory in his book, The Political Economy of Growth. Paul Barron's book, The Political Economy of Growth, has been a seminal book in the dependency theory of modernization, of development. Other eminent contributors to the theory are André Gundar Frank, F. H. Cardoso, Samir Amin, and Immanuel Wallerstein, to name a few. As opposed to the modernization theorists' view of underdevelopment as a state or condition, the dependency theorists regard underdevelopment as a process. Let me explain it. What the modernization theorists believe that the countries are underdeveloped, but what the dependency theorists believe is that it is because of the action of the developed countries that the underdevelopment had taken place in the underdeveloped countries. This theory negates the contention that third world societies are in a primitive traditional state. Rather, they say that these societies had long association with the capitalist system, and this association was precisely to be blamed for this underdevelopment. Let me again explain it. What this theory says is that, if you remember what I initially said, was that this modernization theorists believe that the third world countries has a primitive traditional form of society, and because of this they cannot develop. But what the dependency theorists say is that these societies were never primitive. It is because their long association with the capitalist system. To be more clear, because of the long history of colonial rule in these countries, that these underdeveloped countries had become underdeveloped. And this association, and particularly this association, long association, is precisely to be blamed for their underdevelopment. Analyzing the dependency theory, as Bister had commented, the poverty of the third world is not traditional and it is not accidental. As a condition for its own development, the industrial world required cheap raw materials from the third world. The expansion of the industrial world therefore shaped the structure of the emergent third world, deforming it, impoverizing it, and rendering it incapable of balanced development. If it's a long quotation, but if you go thoroughly through it 2-3 times, you'll understand it. I had told you that because of the colonial rule, what does the colonies do? The colonial ruler explore the raw materials of the country they rule. So what they do is they extract all the raw materials, and like with that raw material, they develop their own industries. So because of this cheap raw materials from the third world, they never invest in the industrial growth of the third world. They are only the place from which third, or the source of raw materials. So the expansion of the industrial world is limited to the developed countries. So what happens is that there is a balance of development. The third world countries never get the chance to improve. So what happens? It is deformed, it is improvised, and it is rendered incapable of balanced development. However, it needs to be mentioned here that in spite of all criticism, only modernization theory form the primary basis of funded developments, which had elicited a huge array of development communication initiative. What it means is that whatever be the critique of the modernization theory, the modernization theory is the basis on which development now stands. And because development stands on that basis, so whatever communication has been done or initiatives had been initiated is based on the theory of modernization. So I hope you get till now the idea of modernization and development, how it is interlinked, how modernization, achieving modernization vis-a-vis the third world, Western world, or the first world countries, is what development is. And because of that form of development, you need to have certain infrastructure, certain ideas in place, certain development in place. And by having those development, you can achieve development. But how to inform people about what is this form of development, what is modernization, you have to have communication built into it. So this is how development communication initiatives had been initiated. Now let us trace the development of, or the history of, development communication. The 20th century saw massive expansion of media and mass communication. You are students of mass communication, and even those people who are not students of mass communication, they would understand that 20th century has been a boom in the technology of media and communication, and it saw massive expansion. Basically, television had got a huge boost all over, and television had changed the entire idea of media or mass communication. So what happened was, political scientists, sociologists, psychologists, all were quite interested to understand the effect of technology and how it influences people at the level of society as well as individual. They had seen a number of studies were done. If you had gone through many other theories of communication, you would understand how media was a very interesting idea of research for sociologists, political scientists, and psychologists to understand human behavior, human reaction to media, how media was so important for them. This led to the formulation of many communication theories, which essentially looked at communication as one-way process, more in the line of bullet theory. If you remember your bullet theory, what does it say? That you have a target, you have a message which is sent to the target receives it, and the communication process is complete. So from that point of view, it was analyzed, and many theories were based on this particular, based on the line of bullet theory. It was increasingly believed, it was more believed that mass media could set an agenda for public discourse. If you read through your McQuayle, you will understand. So I don't want to go extensively into it, but if you rewind a little bit or refresh your memory, what McQuayle was said, had said that influencing public opinion, persuading or educating in the context of planned campaign is what media had helped people to do. Some scholars could see links between culture and communication, and saw communication as shared meaning versus information transmission or persuasion. In this sense, the process and institution of communication, of culture and of development are all woven together. That's what Melkote and Steves had said. So it, some people could see the culture coming in between communication and how it becomes a very complex system of transmission. The processes and institutions of communication and culture comes together, and of development are then woven together. So it's a very complex process is what a group of scholars looked at it as. This focus on the intertwined nature of culture and communication makes some scholars to contend that communication could solidify hegemonic values and priorities in society. Let me explain it. What is hegemonic values? A value which has a hegemony over the entire society, and of course priorities which are set, already made. So there is an agenda setting tendency in communication, because it is a complex system of culture and communication coming together. So communication can of course make people believe that this is how it is, this is how it should be. Just look at a few films that you have seen recently, look at a few advertising you have seen recently, you will see that certain values are propagated. If you remember some interesting advertisement, say the Tanishq advertisement on a women's remarriage. In fact, that is not a hegemonic value, but that can achieve. A lot of people had actually felt empowered when they saw that advertisement. Similarly, the way rituals are done in a film does have an effect on how the ritual is practiced in the real society. There had been comment then that the salwar kameez had become ubiquitous in the society thanks to the television. On the basis of the above theoretical framework, the scholars of development communication can be divided into basically two groups. And it's based on their understanding of the philosophy informing communication. One group believe that communication is organizational delivery system. What does it mean? It means that there is an organization which has a systemic form of delivery. It means that communication is not something which is spontaneous. Basically, it has a target to be achieved, information to be delivered, and so it is a very organized form. And the other group regards it in a broader perspective as related to culture and society. For those who believe it as an organizational delivery system, it in fact, if you look at it, it conforms to the idea of development as a process of modernization. How? We will know when we go down the class. In such case, communication and information is left to the role of a persuasive tool. What communication does or information does is persuade people to do certain things to become modern. I'm diluting and explaining it very easily. If you go to the nuances of the process, you will understand that it is a process which tries to persuade you all throughout. That this is how you should behave. This is how, look at the sanitation campaign. What does it say? Wash your hands. wash your hands, repeatedly asking you to wash your hands. Why? Because that will ensure that a number of diseases does not go into the human body. And then they also have a process of showing you how to wash your hands, with what to wash your hands. So what it does is that this is how you wash your hands, and because you have to be free of diseases, and this is how you achieved a disease-free society. And a disease-free society is another form of modernization. In this process, technology, which symbolizes modernity, helps information to be disseminated. Let me again explain. What is the technology used? Technology is the TVCs, television commercials, or the radio commercials, or the print commercials. This is where the technology comes in. And through this technology, information is disseminated. Thus, development communication under the modernization framework becomes process of persuasive marketing. I am actually combining a lot of things inside it, but will calm down. Under the modernization framework, now you all understand, I hope, that whatever development communication is visible or is being practiced in the society is based on the modernization framework. So under this modernization framework, while tracing the growth of discipline of development communication, Royal D. Cole in 2008 had said that the process of development communication comprises of 7 threads and patterns. There are 7 threads and patterns which weaves into and becomes gives rise to or gives a body to the entire process of development communication. And this is how the stream is built. According to him, the seven are contributions of organizations like UNDP and of course individuals like Erskine Childers, then extension education, community participation, population and health communication, social marketing, institution building, and the information communication technology. The pioneering initiative in the field of development communication is generally traced to the United Nations unit called the Development Support Communication Services. Development Support Communication Services was operated or basically had been given a fillip by UNDP and Childers. Erskine Childers was an individual, he was a broadcaster, he was a journalist, and he was a key person to give that entire Development Support Communication Services a direction. Childers had interestingly written no books, but actively advocated the necessity of regarding communication as the integral component of every development project. He had convinced everyone that if you don't have a communication component built into a development project, it will be hard for the people to practice and then understand why. You have a component. Say you have an education program. For example, in India, we have Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. What does the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan say? That people should be educated. You should send your children to school. 100% enrollment, no dropout. The midday meal built into it. The number of health schemes built into it. But why would the people send you their children if they don't know what are the components of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan? Why would people really feel interested to send their children to school if they don't understand what they will get out of it? Education, fine. But they also understand that education is up till one limit, it is okay, but beyond that, they cannot send their children to school. So they have to be convinced why primary education is important, why sending the children to the school is important, why less number of dropout in fact achieves a lot of things for the country and the society. And how do you do it? You do it through communication. communicate to the people every day, every moment, telling them, convincing them, look, you have to send your children to school because this is what's going to happen. If your child is educated, she will never, or he will never be bluffed by anyone. He will, or she will achieve a lot in their life, etc., etc. And all this needs to be communicated to the people. So he had convinced people that you should have a development communication built into the development project. The role of all UN organizations involved in development communication, in fact, starts from there. And the second trade, as Cole calls it, is the extension trade. This has been extensively used in the agriculture sector by the World Bank. It has been, just to give you a small data, it has been estimated that the World Bank has provided more than $3 billion in direct support to extension, more than any international donor combined. So you can understand how important development communication is even for them. The US system was exported to India in the second half of the 20th century, largely through a US agency project that helped establish agricultural industry in most of the Indian states. The dominant notion in the extension approach is that individuals will adopt a practice and technology if only they understand what is advocated and know how to carry it out. That was Andreasen, whom I had just quoted. This is actually a part of interpersonal communication. The extension education part was a part of interpersonal communication. The agriculture activists, the agriculture extension officers used to go out to the villages, talk to the people about the schemes, about the seeds, about the manure, about the methods, the modern methods of agriculture, modern methods of sowing, reaping, storing away the seeds, storing away the grains, how to market, how to send it to the market, how to get the minimum support price, and all those things were communicated by the agriculture extension officer, house to house, door to door, at least if not door to door, village to village. The third thread in this fabric of development communication is the community participation thread. If you look at any development project going on in your village or your town or your state, you will see that a lot of community participation is generated. Just remember about the NRHM scheme. What do? They have a village health committee. Look at the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, they have a village education committee. So all these committees are formed so that the people, the community can participate directly into the process. It was again food and agriculture organization which had forcefully inserted the idea of community participation in the development communication field. That is what Cole said. If you want to really understand this, you can go to FAO website and look at the history and you'll find it clearly mentioned there. However, the community participation approach was also practiced by the Puerto Rican Division of Community Education even before it was done by Food and Agriculture Organization or FAO. This is another interesting information that maybe the FAO had taken the idea of community education from Puerto Rico Division of Community Education. Paulo Freire's participatory approach even gave community participation an academic ground. And since the mid-1990s, the World Bank established a policy of participation into program where it was appropriate. Everywhere in every project, if you look at it, the people directly form a group who has a strong voice in deciding what is to be done and what is not to be done in the development project. The third fourth thread, in fact, is the population IEC, information, education, communication, and health communication thread. This is a very important communication thread because what happened through this was that a very strong stream of health communication had got a growth in the country. In this area, the most widely used approach was IEC or information, education, communication. You inform people, educate them through communication, which is meant that the program design was to influence knowledge, motivation, and behavior related to, in fact, for family planning, contraception and family planning, and for health, various other health communication process. For a long time, IEC was regarded as exclusively a part of population and family planning program. And in fact, UNFPA had given IEC a direction. IEC, however, underwent changes due to various issues. Gender inequality, then increasing importance of social mobilization, growth, menace of AIDS, HIV/AIDS, advocacy, social marketing, all those had built into IEC, and it has become a very complex and more scientific form of communication. The John Hopkins University's Center for Communication Program became a major player in designing the communication approach for new IEC. The fifth component is social marketing. This is a process through which development is marketed to the people, and it is believed that if you can sell a piece of soap, you can also sell an idea. This is the mantra of social marketing. The Cole says that social marketing has greatly influenced the way communication and information are incorporated in development programs. Social marketing is, however, often confused with advertising and commercial marketing. Social marketing, in fact, is more nuanced, more culture-specific, more gender-specific, but keeping the wider perspective of development intact. Alan Anderson, in fact, that is his book, Marketing Social Change, which had been seminal in giving social marketing a direction and a theoretical grounding. The sixth component is the institution building that has provided developing nations with organizations, skills, and facilities to carry out development communication. So what Cole had meant by sixth component is that the industrial world had helped by building up institutions in various third world countries to develop their organization, their skills and facilities, and carry out development communication. For example, in the late 1960s, Ford Foundation was instrumental in giving family planning communication a direction. They had trained, they had helped in research, they had in fact given a theoretical direction to family planning, given demography a line of direction, and that is how they had developed a huge resource of development communication personalities in family planning. In fact, Ford Foundation was also instrumental in building up G.B. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology in Uttarakhand state. Food and Agriculture Organization also later contributed, and they had upgraded the Center for Advanced Study Center for Advanced Study for Agriculture Communication. Another agency which has been quite active in institution building is UNESCO. The third medium plan of 1989, you can Google this up, there is an eminent sufficient information on website. If you look at the third plan of 1989 of UNESCO, where communication was specially focused on, and they had written to strengthen communication capacities in the developing countries so that they may participate more actively in the communication process. So UNESCO had given it a different direction. In 1980, after years of debate and discussion in its mandate, UNESCO came out with an international program for development communication. Please do have a look at that. It's a nice booklet on which you can understand how the theoretical development had happened in development communication. And in fact, as a reaction to that mandate, if you know Film and Television Institute of India, which is located in Pune, they had got a huge fund for infrastructure development. Cole calls the last trade a parallel or a sub-component of the sixth trade, that is ICT, Information Communication Technology. ICT had in fact been used in the development sector for a long time. Rural radio forums of the 1950s, if you have gone through your history of radio, you most probably understand that rural radio forums were so active and so much into the it is like a community participation process. The forums were built and they used to talk to the people, talk to the policymakers directly through there. Of course, at that time it was snail mail. People used to write letters to the radio centers and the experts used to comment back on program itself that such and such person had written a letter and he wanted to know this, so they give the information. Then I hope you know about satellite instructional television experiment, which had worked on through the satellite experimentation, and it was it had focused on six most underdeveloped areas of the country, and they had for one full year they had disseminated information on development, and that is how satellite was used. So these were few examples of uses of ICT before ICT has been formalized as information communication technology. But with the advent of internet, radio and television, and the increasing use of traditional media, internet it is mooted as the new generation ICT. Internet and uses of radio and television through internet is another area of new generation ICT. For example, this particular class will be available on YouTube very soon. So the information is there online on the internet for anyone to know about this class. Similar things are available in YouTube, similar programs are available on internet, and people understand that this is people whenever you want to access it, it is free to access, and that has given a fillip to the idea of information communication technology. What development communication, whatever it has been practiced, is overwhelmingly the organizational development strategy propounded by UNDP. If you look at, again, let me repeat, if you look at the development communication process being practiced right now, you will see that it has a organizational structure, it has a delivery point, some strategies towards that delivery point, and that if you remember, when I had mentioned about it, that is what UNDP had initially started as development communication strategy. Many multilateral UN organizations, let me take name of few: ILO, UNICEF, WHO, UNHCR, FAO, UNDP, UNESCO, UNFPA. These are providing financial aid according to their own set of goals and affiliation. FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, for example, will provide financial help to development communication in agriculture. WHO will, of course, it's a health organization, so they will fund or give a direction to the development communication in health. Even HCR, human rights, so they will do development communication in human rights. UNESCO will do development communication in their area. UNICEF will do in their area. International Labour Organization. So all these organizations have a huge fund which is given to the organization for development communication and according to the goals and affiliation. Therefore, it is natural that this organization sponsored projects would have development communication activities in their own areas. It is very much visible. In fact, certain areas are overlapping and they come together. WHO can be a part of UNAIDS when they talk about HIV/AIDS communication. So UNICEF will obviously be with WHO whenever there is issues of immunization or health, other health such children's health project. So that is basically what I would like to tell you about development communication. This is a basic idea about what is development communication, how it started. What you need to understand is that development communication is basically a process of communication to achieve development. It is to inform people about what is development, what should be done to achieve development, and of course, what is the ultimate target of development, how you can achieve it, what is your own participation in that communication or in that development process. This is how you achieve development, and this is how communication is important in development.
Okay, so before we go further deep into the development communication, I would like to know how a development journalism is it, what is the area of, for the journalists who are covering the development, and how they will bring out that more the things happening in the development sector?
See, well, of course, journalism is a part of the communication process for development. So mostly communication is done in various ways. One is the institution directly communicating with the people, and one is the institution communicating with the people through media. When it comes to media, development journalism becomes important.
Okay.
So development journalists, basically what the organization which is handling development communication, they generally have a handbook for the development journalists to how to look at their development project and what are the areas. And accordingly, a journalist needs to be very balanced, and he cannot be only talking for the organization, nor can he be only critiquing the organization. So this is what development journalists have to do when they cover a development project.
Okay, when we link this development communication with the sectoral growth like industry, agriculture and services, how you see the whole process will change?
See, it is very tough because there is a debate, huge raising debate, saying that what development communication does vis-a-vis one particular project is to tell the people. Already it's a top-down process, that tell the people that this is what is development. So this is what you have to achieve, which sometimes the people might not be able to accept it, because what happens is, say in India, it's a huge country,
right?
And the geographically we are different, culturally we are different, with our own nuances, own belief. So one project which is successful in Himachal might not be successful in Tamil Nadu, but might be successful in some other state in Northeast.
Right.
So that sort of analysis is very important before going into really achieving something. So even for example, from August 1st to 7th, there is something called Breastfeeding Week. But there are communities in India, hundreds of communities in India, tribals in India, who traditionally does breastfeeding.
Right.
They do not do anything else. So if you communicate to them what they are already practicing, that is a lost communication.
Right.
So what, before actually designing a development communication project or designing any development project, you need to understand for whom it is meant. And that is why community participation comes
very strongly. And especially in case of India, regional practices
very much
need to be
languages, regional practices, where they are done, how it is pronounced. If you don't have a language expert in the place where it is dubbed, the program is dubbed, you will see very messy. Say in your own state, you will see someone speaking a language in such a way where the people are only laughing at it.
Okay.
The thing doesn't register.
Right.
So it's a lot of expertise built into it.
So the one thing is the top down, we have to also see the multi-level opinion, your involvement of opinion makers, opinion leaders. So that need to be taken.
Yeah, the problem with now, the modern opinion makers are very different.
Okay.
Once upon a time, it was the doctor or the teacher in a village who used to be the opinion maker.
Right.
Now it's mostly political. Very much a political leader who is an opinion maker, along with those communication experts. Say we have an Asha in a village, we have a Gram Sevak in a village. All these people are actually given growth to thinking that they will be the opinion maker.
Okay.
But opinion is also made by the media in a huge way. The television makes a strong opinion maker now in the villages. The radio programs become a very strong opinion maker.
So what is the alternative?
Alternative is to use a very judicious mixer, looking at the media consumption habit and the information consumption habit of a particular community. You can decide who is the opinion maker and target that person more than anything else. But one thing has been proved over and over again, that interpersonal communication is the best communication process, whatever might be the other benefits of mass communication. But interpersonal communication becomes, and the peer group communication. A woman would like to get information about contraceptive or health facilities from her own friends or her mother or her auntie, rather than someone coming from outside, a doctor coming from outside and telling her.
Right.
So these are spaces where things are still developing. A lot of things are coming up into it.
So now we come to on a specific things. If we want to communicate development, a specific development. So in that case, as you talked about the organizational, then a strategy, then process and all this. So for any organization, what are the three important points which they need to communicate or which need to be taken care of so that the communication will be accepted, will be understood and will be taken by the
people. This is why community participation is a big component in any development project. What if you look at the handbook that the development project had given, you will see one thing. What they do is that they write that first the community participation component will be given a growth in the organization. They will go and talk to the people, take their views. This is the ideal form of communication, what I am saying, which is never practiced. In fact, it cannot be practiced because of many other things. The people from the development project needs to go to the people, to the masses, and talk to them in group. See, this is what we are trying to give you. Do you want this or you want something different? That communication needs to be started first before actually the project to start. But that is an ideal situation, which is not very much easily achievable, because development, any development project has a target to achieve within a target time. So within 10 months or 1 year or 2 years or 5 years, you have to achieve this. So for this, they also start along with all the projects are started together, which sometimes mess up with the communication process. So ultimately, people end up thinking that this is a pressure on them. This is something which is again put into them. They are not ready to accept that. So we need primary school, you are giving me high school, I don't want it. I need, so this sort of, sometimes that is why the development project fails and falters. But in small societies, small countries, this is the process which they generally follow.
Okay, so this is fact, there is a gap between ideal and practice. But this gap needs to be minimized. So what are the steps here, the study has been taken to minimize this gap? What are the steps which has been suggested by the theorist or the practitioner?
What generally is suggested now, because this is only when the project starts, then they have this component. What the theorists generally say is that before the project is actually ideated, you should go directly to the people, talk and do the research whether such a project is needed in the society or not. If not that project, then what project? Whether a road is more important than a PHC in a particular village is what the research should be. That is why a lot of communication experts are taught village mapping.
Village mapping.
So that the village is mapped particularly and seen what are the gap area. And then after that, the project should be designed. This is what the theorist has been repeatedly saying. See, you want immunization. So you are, what you are doing from 0 to 5 years, you are giving polio 100 number of times, just so that nobody is missed. But are you working, are you really analyzing what can be the effect of so many polio doses to the child?
Exactly.
So there has been rumors. I'm taking it as rumor because polio had not shown that. So there have been rumors that because of this polio vaccination, a child has died. Whereas that might be just coincidental. The child might be already suffering from something else. But that becomes a trigger against a particular program. So this is why a lot of forward research is important. You have to go to the people, understand them, then come and do the project. Not design the project, then start talking to the people.
Okay.
Because they already the children, people feel that, okay, you have already decided. You just want our legitimacy. So that should be minimized by doing a forward-looking research first, and then do the project.
So the focus is shifting from not the implementation of project important, but paramount importance, we can say, rather designing the project paramount.
That is where the focus is shifting. Okay. So you'll see before even when the HIV AIDS projects were taken up, a lot of seminars and research and data was circulated in the society. Then there is always a conspiracy theory going on that we need not talk. But then a lot of information is already available in the society that HIV AIDS is going to be a menace. So now we need to work on it. Then the project had come. In a very small way, but it had been started like that. The data shows that primary health is in a very abysmal shape, and after that NRHM had come. But the problem is that where NRHM will focus in which area is something which was never done, because of which there has been a lot of misgivings. But slowly it's been accepted. People are accepting that, okay, this is also a very good project and we get better facilities.
Okay. So one thing is the miscommunication is also sometimes a big problem, and that that proved to be a hurdle for implementing the projects. Mm-hmm. So, okay, we will discuss this, but before with that, we take up a call from Uttar Pradesh. Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Good afternoon,
good afternoon.
हाँ मैम, मुझे पूछना है कि सोशल मीडिया मैडम क्या रोल प्ले कर रहा है डेवलपमेंट के लिए.
ओके फाइन, वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन.
हाँ
सोशल मीडिया,
हाँ एक बात यही है कि सोशल मीडिया कहाँ से मिलता है. तो हमें इंटरनेट से मिलता है मैक्सिमम सोशल मीडिया. तो यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ मच पीपल आर एक्सेसिंग कैन और नॉट ओनली आर कैन एक्सेस सोशल मीडिया, कितने कर सकते हैं, इंटरनेट का रीच क्या है इंडिया में. तो उस हिसाब से सोशल मीडिया अभी भी मिडिल क्लास और अर्बन फेनोमेनन रह गया है. लेकिन ये नहीं है कि ये नहीं, इसका और प्रोलिफरेशन नहीं होगा और हर जगह नहीं जाएंगे, धीरे धीरे वो जाएंगे. तब सोशल मीडिया का काफ़ी स्ट्रॉन्ग महत्व रहेंगे, बहुत स्ट्रांग ही इम्पोर्टेंस रहेंगे. और डेवलपमेंट के लिए ये बहुत स्ट्रांग डेवलप कंट्रीज में अभी हो ही गए हैं. एवरी वन इज अचीविंग सोशल यूजिंग सोशल मीडिया टू इन्फॉर्म इच अदर. तो हमारे यहाँ भी हो जाएंगे जल्दी. लेकिन इसके लिए गवर्नमेंट का इंटरनेट के ऊपर पॉलिसी और स्ट्रांग होना चाहिएगा, एक्सेस और रीच स्ट्रांग होना चाहिएगा यंग, ताकि इंडिया में सबसे स्ट्रांग कंपोनेंट ही है अभी यंग पॉपुलेशन. तो ऑब्वियसली ये जल्दी ही सोशल मीडिया डेवलपमेंट के लिए बहुत महत्व रखेंगे.
ओके सो अभी जो प्रोजेक्ट लिए जा रहे हैं डेवलपमेंट कम्युनिकेशन लेकर चल रहे हैं, तो उसमें सोशल मीडिया को इंक्लूड किया जा रहा है और किस हद तक?
देखिए अभी तो फिलहाल ये चल रहा है, मोबाइल टेलीफोनी हैज बिकम अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कंपोनेंट इन डेवलपमेंट कम्युनिकेशन. क्योंकि मोबाइल एक डिवाइस है जो इंडिया में बहुत स्पीडली इसका ग्रोथ हो गया है. ऑलमोस्ट एवरी हाउस एवरी पर्सन हैज पास, अगर डेटा को अच्छी तरह देखा जाएगा, क्योंकि मेरे पास अभी फिलहाल डेटा नहीं है, लेकिन जो डेटा है अवेलेबल इसमें इंटरनेट में है, पूरा जगह में है, आपको पता चलेगा दैट मोबाइल हैड बिकम अ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर कम्युनिकेशन. सो अ लॉट ऑफ प्रोजेक्ट्स हैव बीन यूजिंग मोबाइल. जैसे कि NRHM इज स्ट्रॉन्गली यूजिंग मोबाइल्स इन प्लेसेस. हर एक आशा को एक मोबाइल दिया जाता है, डायरेक्टली फोन पे डॉक्टर के साथ आप बात कर सकते हो. द आशा कैन कनेक्ट द पेशेंट विद द डॉक्टर डायरेक्टली. तो ये तो इट्स ICT के जो दो सेवन कंपोनेंट था कम डेवलपमेंट कम्युनिकेशन थ्रेड का, वो ICT है. ICT में मोबाइल हैज बिकम अ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग प्लेटफॉर्म. एंड विद द वे इंटरनेट इज बीइंग इंक्रीजिंगली बीइंग एक्सेस्ड इन मोबाइल, तो आई एम वेरी श्योर वेरी सून मोबाइल विल बिकम द रियल प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर सोशल मीडिया एज वेल एज मीडिया कम्युनिकेशन फॉर डेवलपमेंट.
ओके एक और दर्शक हैं, दर्शक सवाल. ओके सॉरी डिस्कनेक्ट. आप तो मोबाइल टेलीफोन इज बीइंग यूज्ड बाय द
डेवलपमेंट सेक्टर वेरी सीरियसली.
ओके सो वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट अ सेक्टोरल रिस्पांस. तो दिस इज बिकॉज वी लुक एट द इन डिफरेंट सेक्टर, एग्रीकल्चर, इंडस्ट्री एंड सर्विसेज नाउ. सो हाउ वी कैन इंटीग्रेट ऑल ऑफ देम ऑन रीच टू द
See, certain things can be integrated, okay, but certain programs cannot be. For example, agriculture and health had been always, there has been a linkage between both. Jaise ki, if you look at, and say UNICEF, one organization like UNICEF, I had in fact mentioned about it. UNICEF and WHO comes together when it comes to certain projects.
Okay.
So, that is achievable, but certain programs cannot be integrated completely. But there is an increasing necessity to integrate many programs together, for because that way people don't get lost at what's happening. So that this is important.
Okay. So and what about the we'll talk about development communication professional status in India? How it's coming?
See, development communication is being taught in various universities as well. Professionally, I am not very sure how many professionals are really working in the normal sector, but in every development organization, every multilateral, bilateral development organization, there's a huge, strong component of development communication experts, sitting there discussing, deliberating. And every development project going on in the country, NRHM, Sarva Shiksha, look at so many programs. Everywhere there is a communication expert. It's not that there is not, they are not there. But the problem is now in India, I think we still have a long way to go to give development communication a more stronger theoretical basis, because of which it might be integrated into a project, but we are not looking at India-specific development communication. It is again a top-down process.
Okay.
The UN organization tell us that this is how you do the development, but we have to design our own development communication
process. So what could be those elements that need to be included to make it India-centric?
We have to remember one thing. India is a country where oral communication is very strong. We have a strong history of oral literature. In spite of leaflets being given here and there or advertisement or whatever, you need to have a man-to-man, door-to-door talk.
Okay.
Integrating all. If you remember, MENA project was very successful. MENA project was very successful.
Right.
And such projects are more important.
So, for the development communication in India, we need to give importance to the oral communication. So, well, friends, with these words, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on your behalf, I thank Dr. Saraswati Goswami for giving such an insightful lecture on this very topic. Thank you very much.